they can go from being in that fifth, sixth spot to being tied for third with a couple of other people there. So if Energy are going to start proving that they're the real deal, because there have been some question marks around this squad and the communication, mm-hmm. this is the game that they do it. They have to beat Cloud9, a team above them in the standings, to make that statement.
So does the Nidalee get banned out or taken out by Rush this game? The Kog'Maw surely finds himself on the bench.
Yep. I think Fiora's a ban.
Gangplank will be falling that way as well, most likely.
I think Fiora's a ban that we're going to be seeing now pretty much every game in North America, with Ryze no longer being a ban that you have to make. Fiora is 15-1 in North America, and that one win is Huni. Or that one loss is Huni against Huni as Quinn. So Huni played a strong Quinn into a Fiora, which is a great counter matchup. But I think we're going to see Fiora banned, because North America, we don't seem to know how to deal with that champion just yet. So NA Fiora, not much stronger than NA Quinn.
We make the champions here, but we don't know how to fight them yet.
It's true.
Kalista is going to be one for Energy, and the third one, it will be Nidalee.
All right.
On the side of Cloud9.
Zulu up.
Moon won't get that. Alistar first pick for Energy. They do not hesitate to make sure it's theirs.
And so they give Conquan an initiator, and I know that Conquan, his Alistar used to be something that he played a ton, and he was really good at it. Recently, though, his Alistar, he's had to kind of scrape off some of the rust and get back into the feel of that champion.
Yeah.
C9, though, jumping over to their squad, Lulu is available. You pick your jungler and Lulu, and then you can set up that composition. You can pick Corki and then flex it here. There's a lot of options, as well as Poppy. So I think taking a flex pick here alongside your jungle, or if the flex pick is your jungler, you can pick up your support, or you can pick up a contested AD carry. There you go.
Will be a support type pick. There you go. Lulu to the mid lane.
Yep.
Rush will get Lucian for Sneaky.
Yeah, it's a contested AD carry. Pick it up.
Yep.
Lucian, Lulu, I was talking about this last game. SKT loved this combination and made it very popular.
The Lulu Lucian.
Oh, other side already locked in.
Yeah, Energy is going very fast with this. AD carry is going to be the name of the game for them, having that front line of Alistar. So they're going to have a bit of peel. We'll see what else they decide. Gragas may be working out for them.
Hey, you. Yes.
Or. That being the jungle.
Yeah, great. Exactly. That could be a top lane for Impact.
Right.
I think it's going to be a jungle here. Graves is nerfed on 6.3, where he has the 0.25 second delay before his Q blows up when it hits a wall. It gives appropriate recognition time, not so much reaction time. Reaction time is more of like a 0.5 second thing in our game.
Right.
Where before it was instant, so people would, it would go off and you'd be like, what killed me? And you'd be frustrated. So 0.25 seconds gives you the time to go, oh, that's why I died.
A little more clarity. So Morgana actually locked in here, and Sneaky's going to grab the Lee Sin for Rush, so they're going to be switching those champs. But supporty going over here for the side of Cloud9. Remember, Hai was taking Soraka and her utility last time in yesterday's game, so still looking to protect as much as he can his AD carries and the rest of the team.
Yeah, he played multiple Morgana games so far in the last few weeks, picking up Qs. Bunny Foo Foo playing some pick champions when the Alistar is taken away as a first pick, which is why they picked it up on Energy's side. Deny that from high.
Really?
And that's the worth they put on it. Oh, do it!
It's GBM.
Do it!
Anything. It could be anything.
But
like Army yesterday. They are holding 5 seconds left on the pick. There was quite a bit of discussion going back and forth between Alltech here. They are confirming it'll be the Karma. Play a little back and forth game, but he locks the Karma in once again. He really liked what that provided for the team, and he actually had a great mid lane.
The Elimination will look across to the other coach, be like, I see your Karma. Nice pick. Where'd you get that? But the Karma there for GBM played it yesterday to great effect, and he was able to speed his team up, allow these engages to happen, and they came away with a clean win versus Dignitas, only giving up 2 deaths. And that's once again going to be Impact on that top lane Nautilus, something that he loves playing. It's peel, it's engage.
They still got some fantastic picks for picking a support first.
Oh, yeah.
Like, that's a team that is Energy right there. Whole lot of damage and whole lot of keep going forward.
Yeah, it's mostly a 5-on-5 composition. Yeah. You don't want to fight them in any closed spaces because Karma's Q with the Mantra. You have to run through a Nautilus Riptide and also just Blue Ezreal on top of Graves damage. So fighting in the jungle is what Energy wants to do.
Okay.
You don't want to do that. C9's comp, that Twisted Fate locked in last. Little skirmishy here. A little bit back and forth on that skirmish power. Their 5-on-5 may not be as apparent. They can still do that, but it's one of those compositions where high execution will give you that lead and will give you an ability to close out the game.
Lulu top lane then. See how Balls provides. He'll definitely have a lane pressure. But I don't know if we'll really be able to go toe-to-toe if we see Moon going towards that top lane. It'll be hard to gank, which will be in Balls' favor, but this is a switch now. We've kind of seen that Balls was on the up-and-up for carries, being very strong for the team. This is definitely a role switch.
Yeah, it's definitely a role. Balls had that's the number one single best performance in damage per minute in the North American LCS this split,
right.
That 1,200 damage. Balls actually also holds the record right now for worst non-support damage per minute with the Fiora game. Still won it, though.
That's right.
Also, another fun fact is that in that Gangplank game, he did 100 times more damage than his Fiora game to champions.
There you go.
Yep.
Because math. But before we head into game, let us know who you think is going to win. As usual, tweet at LOL Esports with the hashtag EnergyWin or the hashtag C9Win. And we'll update the fan vote in just a few minutes. Looks like it's going to be a pretty hairy game for both teams. A lot of fighting going to be happening throughout this entire match. And that's what I like to see, Sam.
Yeah, Rush is going to be looking for those kicks to break up the fight, make skirmishes happen high with the picks. This composition can pick you off on C9's side. Twisted Fate will be able to come down on top of you. You also have the Morgana bindings. Lee Sin singles people out. Just a really good composition for that.
Just kidding.
Lulu Twisted Fate is also a little bit underrated. A Twisted Fate with a yellow card on him and the whimsy to speed him up is incredibly frightening.
Yep.
You're going to get caught at that point. So Energy, they need to rely on some of their tanks. They have GBM for the speed increase. He's also taken Cleanse to deal with the Twisted Fate and the Morgana. We'll see how this happens or how this plays out for Energy with their tanky members.
See Con Con talking to the QA dudes. We'll see what's going on and get that fixed up right quick. This team that you were just talking about, Cloud9, synergizes so well with the speed ups, the slows. They'll have the Frost Queens coming in as well from high towards the late game. So like you said, if any stragglers on the side of Energy, and that is going to be picked off immediately.
It's actually interesting because Energy want to fight you 5-on-5 in the jungle, and then C9 want to pick you while you're rotating in the jungle.
Right.
And get you in that regard. So if Energy stay as a 5-on-5 or 5-man unit, they still can't get split pushed down, though. Because if Lulu builds Lich Bane, it's a 1-3-1 with a Twisted Fate, and you have two ways to collapse. So both compositions, there's no like, oh, this one beats the other one, right? It comes down to execution here. So I'm really excited to see how this game plays out.
And Energy, looking at the comp, looking at yesterday, you have from Karma down the same thing, Karma, Ezreal, Alistar.
Yeah.
And it's almost like what Kiwi Kid was saying to Freak in his interview, is we've been driving this composition home, and it's been working for us. So they almost try to put together the same thing.
Yeah.
It was Poppy and Nidalee last time, but you still have tank and impact on Nautilus and damage from that grade.
Exactly. And I think having Moon, the way that this team, Energy, are going to operate best is if Moon is on a damage dealer, and then Impact is on an initiator, because Impact can speak with GBM, and then he can speak with Con Quan, who follows up initiations. Whereas Moon can't really speak to GBM too well. And your Moon, you know, GBM does understand English perfectly fine, but it is always hard for GBM to communicate with Moon what he wants to do, what he wants Moon to do.
All right, so looks like Con Quan's keyboard is all fixed up. We are back in the game. We'll see what both teams have for each other in these early vision back and forth. So just knowledge of starting camps. Easy peasy stuff, orthodox starts on both sides. Looks like we actually might get our lane matchup here as well.
Oh, even mantra'd that one.
Advantage Energy.
Some bad juju right there. Let's see. C9, no deep wards here to see lane swaps. They'd only see that Alistar on the bottom side camp, so they spot out that it will be a 2-on-2. They've already shown themselves as well, so Energy, the jig is up on that. I'm actually quite interested with Balls on a supportive top laner, because Balls has the lowest kill participation on his team at 53%. And Impact actually has the highest kill participation on his team at 82%.
Wow.
So
it's actually quite
Balls, he's been playing a split push role this season for his team.
Mm-hmm.
And Impact's been playing the team fighting role, the tank, the bruiser.
Only missed one. Yeah, he is that option for the team, though. Change whatever you want. We saw him going back to Maokai. We saw him doing different things. And he actually plays everything to a pretty high level.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Impact is a jack-of-all-trades top laner.
Yeah.
He's very versatile. I think he could play pretty much whatever you ask him to. Balls, though, Balls is also very versatile. Like Dyrus was saying on the desk alongside Kobe, he's been around a very, very long time. He's been playing as long as these guys have, so he knows his way around that champion. He knows his way around a lot of champions.
Right. It's also, it's difficult. Changing champions, you know, you pick it, you play it, but changing the mentality and making sure you're playing it the right way and not just carrying over one from the other is also difficult.
The thing is, when you diversify your champion pool, you get a better idea of how to play many different styles.
Right.
Right. If I just play something that's exactly the same every time.
You always play attack.
For example, a lot of junglers adapting to 80 carries in the jungle as opposed to initiators like Zac was a big shift for them, and we saw some people not really jump on that train because the 80 carries were difficult. And they actually like being tanky and have this kind of loser mentality where I'm helping by shielding people. So Moon, though, hasn't had to make that transition too hard, because he's been playing a lot of Nidalee, a lot of Evelynn, and he just likes to kill people in the jungle. But for Moon, he's actually never been a part of any of the First Bloods for Energy.
Right.
Energy actually only have one First Blood in their 10 games, and they actually average down gold at 15 by about 600 gold. So Energy, their early game is rather rough, and they've been relying on GBM to kind of pull out a Miracle Team fight a couple times. Baron steals.
It's kind of, it reminds me of the way Team Liquid used to work when you'd see Phoenix on Azir. They kind of hover around, get a consistent laning phase, and then Phoenix would explode in those team fights.
Yeah. That player is worth like 400 gold. See what happens.
Early flash is going to be nice, especially without having a whole lot of crowd control in that lane.
Yeah, it was a little early, but it also might have been a little late, too, because he took a decent amount of damage there and had to use some potions. He had just used his flash initially, but he had to make sure because was the tether going to actually root him at that point? Was he able to break it? But GBM speeding himself up. I actually think that Karma's kit is super intuitive, because all of the abilities synergize together. E to speed yourself up, W the person, as soon as they're rooted, Mantra Q.
Right.
Big burst of damage.
For more catch up.
It's just so, and this ability allows me to do this one, which allows me to do this one. So it's really got a really nice flow to that kit.
A lot more are picking it up. I'm sure Bjergsen still has the knowledge of that play. Maybe not the composition the team's been working on. And that's kind of something that Energy, I feel, can do as well. While they're putting together somewhat of the same comp, they make these choices to actually go for something that nobody's been playing and create a composition around that. It seems to be working for them.
Yeah, whatever works for your team.
This time, the Karma.
Yeah, whatever works for your team, you should continue to do, but not to a fault, because we saw that at Worlds with a couple of Tristana Ezreals, or Tristana Azirs from North America, where we had pretty much one strategy that was working in that meta and slow to adapt. It worked for a bit, and then everybody caught on. But you need to be able to diversify your playbook, which Dignitas in last game showed that they can. And Energy, they have as well. They have a very diverse playbook here. Yeah. But the thing is in Champions they do. But playing through GBM seems to be how this team has been winning.
Ever since level 2 high, been trying to hit these bindings. Good dodges by Energy, but they've kept the pressure on. CS is relatively even throughout this entire laning phase so far. And the wards are keeping everyone safe. The only gank we saw was on Jensen. They have a repeat of just about 2.5 minutes to do that again. Moon's already trying to clear vision to make that a possibility.
Going for the invade here. Graves, you always want to be able to fight people in the jungle. Blow it up. But Rush, he loves fighting too.
The Sixth Sense comes back. He takes double damage on that.
Oh, he's going to wait for it. There you go. Oh, he'd be followed.
There's the safeguard over to the ward. This is actually going to go to Jensen. He gets a piece of it just for walking up and saying hello. This could already be bad. That's a 20 CS difference just about in that lane. But the level 6 won't be able to come in. They don't get under the turret fast enough.
Rush picking on Moon there. Moon thought he was the aggressor. Rush, you should know this guy by now from all the games that he played last year. He'll fight you. Rush doesn't run away from fights unless he gets something.
So
one fight
lovely.
There for him.
Yep.
Like, he doesn't run away from fights, but then make me a liar.
Cast your curse.
Run away.
Wow. Toying with impact. Keeping him off a few of the waves. Or a few of the minions, I should say. Not a few of the waves. He wasn't gone for that long. But just a bit of a gold lead there grabbed by Cloud9. And great pressure as well, especially for the call to Jensen. A quick move up there. Nobody really had the aggression in that lane, so Jensen made sure he could get up to get that kill.
Yeah, that 1,000 gold up there. There's about 300 gold in favor of balls in the top lane.
See this but again.
This Moon doesn't get the instant Jensen off the wall.
Right
does,
away, too.
Does take a second. Actually, it did go off the wall. Jensen moves right away. Moon. GBM's trying to speed him up. Not enough. Yeah, fighting Lee Sin in the jungle, despite him not being a warrior enchant Lee Sin, he's going for a Cinder Hulk here. You're still not going to be able to do enough. I think that he was going for some tracker's knife wards over the Krug pit and stuff like that. So Moon was just trying to keep tabs on Rush. He found him.
I mean, they have great but, wards on that side. Yeah. It's 1, 2, 3, right up. Just a security line. Got to be careful, though. That's exactly the composition we said that C9 would be. Very skirmishy. They'll look to find those one-off fights and take you down right away.
Oh, yeah. I think Lee Sin got a range indicator on his Q, so we're going to be seeing a lot of that every time he lands a Q, if he can take it. I believe it shows up in Spectator. Or else I was just, my eyes were lying to me for a second there.
The Sonic Wave sight.
Yeah, that's the thing. After you cast 3 games in a row, your sight starts to go. You start seeing hallucinations on the Rift. He flashed!
Things are happening that aren't happening. Low mana for balls here.
Yeah, that's kind of a giveaway.
This guy with 300 health is just walking up on me. Blows a flash, though. It seemed like balls took to respect that too quickly. May Fizz get a repeat coming in from Moon. Now, also, we just said at that like moment I was saying there's about 2 minutes 50 seconds left on Jensen's flash was when Moon went to the top side jungle. So maybe he was actually thinking that was going to play into his favor. He gets another one top. We'll see if he repeats there, though.
Yeah, but warding by yourself on that side, you really have to have your,
right.
your laners play towards you in the all tech.
There's one. Conquan being a big meat shield. The dive in, the shield is
oh,
off!
Six.
The soul shackle is
in range!
Oh, he got him into the turret! You gotta be kidding! The best of a worst situation!
Oh.
Conquan makes it happen! Very nicely done! And now Cloud9's forced to try and run out of this one. The shield is on, so waiting for the hook to come back up for all that to happen. There it is, just gonna get the True Shot Barrage out.
And Altec
make it work.
Picks up 2 kills for himself. We've been talking about his damage per minute. He's been looking on the rise here. And whenever Impact is playing a very tanky top laner, like when he ends up playing or something that has versatility to it, something that can peel and can initiate Poppy Nautilus, that's when Altec actually does the most damage per minute in his games. High is level 5. He's waiting for that cannon to die, and then he'll hit 6. Dies, hit 6. Sneaky was already 2 levels up. But then right there, Conquan's Alistar coming up big, and the TP channel from Impact. He actually gets an assist on the back of that, too. So the hook hits as the Q comes through. And then GBM was already en route. Jensen was coming back from the base there. So GBM utilizing that Karma speed to get there just in time and cut off the retreat from high.
Okay.
And now it's still a 2,000 gold advantage for Cloud9.
Yeah. And we'll see what Rush can do now. He has Herald. We'll see where he decides to use that pressure. Red buff is on as well, so they may be able to get a catch and run down fight here if Altec stays. Yeah, they are actually going to get the kill that they're looking for. It's how long is it going to take is really the question. High's got the tank, easily seen. He's able to walk out with just 3 turret shots.
Yep.
And they were making sure that happened in favor of Cloud9 after the mistake they just made.
Have to get something in return for this.
Right.
So some mid lane turret damage. I don't think Energy are going to be able to take this at all. Just some chip damage there. But allowing Cloud9 to get through your jungle and all the way to Altec definitely is something that
they
can't answer.
It was more brute forced as well. As soon as we saw them come back up, they were instantly going for that kill. So
yeah.
I think they were kind of trying to play off the, we'll take them off guard, but that's not going to always work.
This 2,000, it's almost a 3,000 gold advantage here for Cloud9. It's just all across their lanes. Balls, he's about 700 gold up in this top lane, purely based off of CS. The jungle, Rush is 500 up. And then Jensen's almost 1,000 gold up in that mid lane here. Twisted Fate passive helps him out as well as those kills.
Yeah.
And first blood.
Pushing in right now, so we may actually see that. His ultimate's down, so he won't be doing too much roaming. He'll stay for these waves. But it's not going to be coming towards him too fast. GBM back towards the mid. May actually be able to cut off Jensen and do a bit of entry damage on the lane. 12 minutes
Sneaky.
In.
Level up.
3,000 gold lead. Could be a little bit more. The first auto attack, so Sneaky can get the light binding to hit. Or rather, piercing light, I should say. And it did not work out well for Sneaky. He was expecting Balls to be there a little bit sooner and get that wild growth on. Balls to use that TP. He did. And now it does not look like it's going to be a good situation.
Got to dodge
him.
The next glitter lance.
He's using the minions. Oh, he used the minions for damage. He actually gets the kill. He'll be taken down by the cow. But that was not what Altec was thinking was going to happen.
Nope.
Another fight towards the top lane. Rush trying to hit the Sonic Wave. Impact flashes the binding. And they both get out of that sticky situation. 4-4 now, as Bloodish almost shred across the map.
Yep, 2-for-1 there. TP out of balls. Only clear in the mid lane by GDM. So more kills going over to Altec, one going over to Conquan. And then the cleanup there from balls with his own life. So he completes his Rod of Ages, 12-minute mark. That final Glitter Lance, though, just barely. And I think that was so well played by Energy, because mm-hmm. that was a level advantage for Sneaky. And Sneaky, he's got the right idea. Blue Ezreal, you want to take advantage of that tier before he ends up getting decent armor from the Glacial Shroud. So go ahead, engage when you have BF Sword and you have your call fields. But Conquan Flash Headbutt Pulverize is what turned that around. And then I also like the fact that Altec waited and waited to actually come back in towards Balls, because Balls had to use his E and Q onto Conquan, because Conquan was peeling Balls away. So out of frustration, he used all of his damage onto Conquan the first round, which allowed him to take even more. But yeah, we might be seeing, like, this game is between a team that's potentially Cloud9 wins, tied for second, and then Energy, who are sitting in fifth right now, I believe. So this is a game that might be showing us a little bit of Energy's ceiling right now, the place that they're at. Because Cloud9 had a rough start. They were jumbling up their roster. Energy, same story a little bit with some of the substitutions. And then they were able to get everybody together. GBM was figuring out how they wanted to play League of Legends together. And now Energy, we're seeing this point two-thirds of the way through the split. And look at this. Picking on GBM.
There's the cleanse right away. Fast fingers. GBM looks to put more damage back down. The smoke screen comes out. Wasn't a gold, it was the blue, but there was really no pursuit after the card anyways. It was just to deter the fight very fast in the mid lane. You can see how quick both teams can be in and out of these engagements. Should be the push here. GBM, I don't know if he wants to stay in clear. He knows there's going to be...
He's got Mantra, so he might Mantra Q, clear those casters.
Yeah, look for the caster wave. Siege stays up, that's going to be the first to tank. And it only means a few shots on
All right. Top lane, Impact with Banner of Command first against the magic damage dealer. I really like this. It's going to take Lulu forever to clear him out. You pretty much just use wimpy auto attacks all day on it.
We already saw it going in Impact's favor when they were just up there the last time. Balls was down to about half HP, just glitter lancing through, worrying about the waves, not the Nautilus. And now it's going to get some vision in that bot lane. It's mid still getting pushed. Jensen trying to stay safe. Knows that Headbutt Pulverize was just on cooldown, so he can take a few steps forward.
Nice Lich Bane hit there. Was not a gold card again. It was a blue card from Jensen. Maybe could have been able to pick up Conquan there. It was.
Go.
Yeah.
It was Zine.
Rush, though. Rush is very active this game. Looking for Conquan.
Ooh. Teleport stop.
Yep, flash E there from Altec. They also got the TP out of Impact. And now Energy, they're running out of outer turrets, and they're running out of areas that they can siege as five effectively.
I was just going to say that. They're so spread out. They haven't
Rush,
been able to do their composition.
Exactly. And when you lose these outer turrets, it means that when you push up, there's more room for Twisted Fate to ulti behind you.
Yep.
There's more room for Rush to find avenues to get behind your team. Because right now, it's 0-3 in turrets. Energy have effectively lost every lane this game.
Banner as well. Could be, or in Energy, I'm saying, one of the big things here. You only have really Sneaky that's going to be able to clear that quickly. I don't know how far it's going to get when it meets every outer turret right away.
Oh,
almost
nice.
Taken.
Yeah.
Very nice try by Altec.
The thing is, once you take it,
yeah,
you still have to pick it up.
The team has to get it.
Oh, GBM got knocked up too by Moon. That kick hit Moon. Into GBM. Rush with a nice clean getaway there.
He's definitely feeling this game. You can see the confidence when he brings it out on Lee Sin.
Yeah.
Just always diving under turrets. We just saw it with Altec in the top lane, making him blow a flash. And it creates a threat as soon as he appears on the screen.
Yeah. Sometimes you land that first Q as Lee Sin, and you're just like, I'm in the zone today. I got my flow going.
This is the game. And then that 40-minute Q you take, you're like, oops.
Yeah. Then you get a little too hype.
That wasn't so much in the zone anymore. A lot of action, very low kill score here to start this one off, but only 4-4 for what we've seen. 15 seconds onto Dragon. Frost Queens to get vision on everybody and make sure they can clear these wards safely and place what they need.
Yeah, energy are flailing a little bit because even though they have a 5-on-5 composition, if you're this far behind before you even get the chance to move up as 5, then it's definitely going to be difficult to even win with the condition that your team has.
Yeah.
Conquan, though, they're looking for the 5-on-5 here towards that Dragon. 2K on it.
It's such a hard fight. 6,000 gold down right now. They're attempting to fight it. Rush gets the smite, and they're going to have the after fight. This could be big. There is the wild growth for Jensen, but he's got
to be Black Shield.
What a hit for Hai. He gets the shield down before he uses the gate, so he gets in without the ability to be crowd controlled. Where's the follow-up damage from C9? Because Energy's doing a nice job at keeping them at bay. There's the damage finally following through. They were waiting for the cooldowns, and Energy just couldn't fire back fast enough.
Rush is taking.
Whoa! Oh, he gets the double! That was a flash in from Conquan to try an instant crowd control, but Jensen was too fast.
That was an almost full wipe there for Energy.
Wow.
C9 coming up huge in these team fights. They're playing the 1-3-1. They're playing the split push of their composition, and then they just group up instantly and deal with Energy. Too much poke at the Dragon. And then TF Jensen, he's been going crazy this entire split. Recognized the opportunity.
Wow.
Continues it.
The black shield.
And then he eats the pulverize. Conquan can't do anything to peel him at that point. And Jensen is just throwing cards constantly. Another blue card. He just wants the DPS at that point. And Impact eats a Q, goes down. Jensen, Rush is tanking the turret so Jensen can get this position. Gold card, flash, point blank. Oh my god.
I don't know if the pulverize would have hit at that point because Jensen took a step as well. But you still got to try to save your mid laner. Failing attempt by Conquan. Unfortunately, giving the 402 over to Jensen now. A sub 20 minute Zhonya's and a Lich Bane with the cooldown boots. They're going after high here. Rush could get a pretty good kick if he lines them up. And he actually just waited for a second. Got locked down. He's good to go, though. And he will just pressure them off by being a brute this game. 105 for himself. 8 kills overall now for Cloud9 as they look to possibly give up mid turret. It wouldn't be that much. It's the first turret they'd be losing this game.
Yeah, you don't have the TP from Balls. A little bit of poke here.
Nice
energy.
Side step.
Balls is running down, though. He has enough AP at this point to give himself a large amount of movement speed. Run straight down from that top lane. Join up fights, 8, no problem.
8,000 gold, 20-minute lead right now for Cloud9.
Energy are becoming more and more exposed as the season goes on. People were expecting them to be in that top. In the top half,
like nine. Standings.
And they risk falling to 6-6 here, being 2 games out from second place.
Yeah, and this will be a big work week for Cloud9 as well. TSM and Energy, as Energy was trying, has been, as we said, finding themselves a little bit with these compositions. Love to get that 8-4. Energy wants to climb to 7-5 and keep themselves in contention for those top spots. The clearing now to come out to play. 20 minutes in here, it's been Cloud9 pretty much in the driver's seat. We'll see if they can keep it that way. If you let GBM and the rest of the team start to farm, Nautilus will get pretty big. They'll be able to utilize this banner in command. They can easily get back in this game. Take a while, though.
Yeah,
to grab 9,000 gold.
It'll take a very long time, especially since Cloud9 now have tools to continue pushing.
Right.
They have tools to engage. You pretty much
Titanic Hydra for
Rush.
That's damage.
I love that. I love that build. Build that every time. Solo queue. Be great. When you're ending up building the team at, though, kind of sucks. But
yeah.
Jarm's Fist covers you for a little bit if you want to just say, right. Hey, I'm building tanky, guys. I'll get there. I'll get resistances
Promise.
Later. It's fine. All he has is just flat health and his entire build gear.
And sometimes at this point in the game, we can say, you know, Energy has a lot of gold to pick
There's
up.
Baron.
But that's going to be so difficult, even though the turret's outer line is right there. Baron being attempted now 22 minutes in. It's really just a fight bait. A huge monster Q from GBM wipes the health bars of Cloud9. The Zhonya's goes off, but it only sets up Jensen to be taken down. And a very bold call by Cloud9 goes very wrong.
This could be how Energy get back into the game. Rush is still alive. He's still right over the wall. He has charges in his Sightstone, his ward, Sneaky!
Baron's not taking much damage. They have to go for the full fight here. They skirmish back in, And will they attempt? It's pretty much staying at the 75% as they take damage. A lot of full health bars
Rush
go in and
count.
Out.
Rush has to count.
He is going to attempt. The pink ward is there. They're going for the save. He sees it at 2,900 HP.
Nope.
He will go for the Krugs and decide not to hit it.
Yep, the call is to not attempt it. Alistar Kongquan walks all the way around.
Wow.
Maybe he would have died if Rush had stayed. Because
Kongquan walked up there.
Such low HP, and he still had...
He was ready to give his life up.
Yeah.
He was going to be like, this is a headbutt to death.
Yeah, but Rush still had Rush still had kick, so, I mean, you land the Q from the bush, and then maybe, but Kongquan would try to outplay it with a pulverize. It was very risky, though, because that just seemed no vision coverage, really, of where Rush was, just checking that area.
That was
still,
risky for Cloud9.
Still.
Why pressure this? They wanted to fight.
Yeah, they wanted to fight.
They didn't
GBM hits high right as the knockup from Kongquan comes out. That was a four-man pulverize from Kongquan. Definitely getting the rust off of his Alistar here.
Very, very well played. He's just got the... Does he have an upgrade? He does already have the distortion, so we'll be able to flash pulverize even more.
Yeah, it's super popular.
Right.
I think I've said this every
time.
Get
it immediately.
Because of the headbutt nerf and movement speed, people go more for the distortion early on now because flash pulverize is just way more reliable now because headbutt's dodgeable, headbutt's slow. That's why it's done.
So all these items Cloud9 had. Seems like they'd be on top of every fight, but a very nice flank out by GBM there. That Mantrid Q set up all the HP bars to be wiped out by the rest of the damage on the team.
Yeah, in Champions, like, when I saw this composition, it's like if you're fighting them in enclosed spaces like the jungle, that Mantrid Q, that Pulverize, even the Altex ultimate coming across people, like this is a team that wants to fight you in those 5-on-5 scenarios.
And that's exactly what Cloud9 was avoiding previously.
Exactly. Their comp is not built for that.
Hitting out Jensen with the shield to go forward and pick somebody else out. Cloud9 actually brought that fight in for energy.
Yeah, they wanted that fight because they had such a gold advantage. And Jat had a really good League of Learning about this exact scenario where you will start leveraging your gold lead instead of your composition's strengths. They tried to use their gold lead as their win condition as opposed to using what their comp is good at doing.
It makes
and energy
sense.
Punished them with what their comp was good at doing despite a gold deficit.
It makes perfect sense for what we just saw. Now on to the next turret. Once they get there, the Graves, the Ezreal, they're going to be able to drop these.
Sneaky!
And possibly the champion. Sneaky very low. Wild Growth goes out. Sneaky alive. Black Shield on, so there's no more follow for him just yet. He's going to be back from the fountain with Home Guards in a second.
Altec's a little caught.
Yeah, he gets out. He was waiting for that Arcane Shift to come back up.
Oh.
A lot of exit damage being taken. But Cloud9 needs to do some clearing here. The Baron really giving energy a bit of time to play with at his turns.
Whenever an AD carry eats a gold card and then I see wild card comes out immediately after, I just stop breathing for a second. I'm just like, how much damage is it going to do? It's like, because Thunderlords will come down if he gets another auto. It's like, oh, it could really just mess you up.
Jensen knows it too. He plays with that confidence in this champion is pretty much what Rush does on that Lee Sin is you have to create a threat factor with how strong you play and how you play that champion up in the front of the fight.
Yeah, and speaking about how people are playing their champions, you see in that top lane, Vols is going towards a Lich Bane, so it is going to be a 1-3-1 most likely here as a win condition for Cloud9. They identified that. Yeah. Getting that Lich Bane allows Lulu to become a gigantic split-pushing threat. Rush, though, covering the top lane. Three members of energy up here. Four members of energy in the top lane. That leaves Cloud9 with three in the mid against Impact. They have to get back fast. If Rush and Balls interrupt back timers, wave clearing as a Nautilus is not easy. If he stops GBM,
Rush heads
blocked
in.
Blocked
it. Yep.
Yep, it didn't block it. So that interrupted the back. That's going to be an inhibitor turret tower. Impact! Oh, he didn't make it over!
Oh, tried to get himself over the wall. The flash did happen, as you see it on cooldown. 46 seconds.
The support
right
made it back.
Now,
that's it. It's only the support. It's only the support that made it back.
Karma's trying to fight it out, so GBM staying in there. Balls is still keeping Moon back. Altec now facing Rush. This is not going to work. This is a full damage Lee Sin coming into the fight. And Sneaky and the rest of the team have actually pulled back to try and rout the rest of the team. But the minions have been stopped up at this top side.
Oh, they're still hunting right now. They're looking for GBM. They're looking for Moon. They're looking for all of these kills. But They might let them go. They might just clear the wave, depending on how energy position after this. It's still a 5,000 gold lead for C9.
Look at that.
Boon swept the bush. He's sitting in here waiting. Oh, man. If energy all find a way to get up here without being spotted.
A few are backing. Now would be the time to pull the trigger if they start going out. Sneaky, no! Uh-oh.
Go for High.
I don't think High can do much. High actually tried to stay there for a second and help him, but he doesn't have much other. He does. He takes down Altec. I am wrong. These are the kills they needed to be coming out before they go down. A few more Valiant attempts, and it's only Altec as C9 loses four. You see Balls is coming back up. He died just a bit ago.
Energy keep doing this in all of their games. When they group up as five, that's when they shine. I talked about how they have a gold deficit at 15 minutes on average, which means it happens a lot.
Is he even hurting him? I think he's healing him.
Nautilus things, man. Just Nautilus things. This is what Energy would do every time. Their team fighting seems to be what's on point. When all five of them are in the same spot, it's a really good team. See here, the divide. GBM recognizes I need to go off the side. Impact was trying to save, but then High, Thunderlords, and the Fermented Soil ends up getting him the kill there onto Altec. So one kill for multiple over there for Energy, and now it's only a 4,000 gold difference. It was, what, 9 at one point?
Yeah, I was just gonna say that. Ever so slowly, it keeps getting closed. We saw a 9,000 gold lead 8 minutes ago, 8.5 minutes ago, and now it's only 4K. Energy really closing this one down and suffocating Cloud9, who has been going for a little too much, overstaying their welcome a bit too long, and that's how they've been losing these ones. Because once they do that and they start to disengage, they lose that factor of being able to skirmish. You have all five people coming at you like Energy wants.
Yeah, Energy definitely want that as their win condition here. Run into this team or allow them
just
to engage into you as five. But Energy, just taking a step back and talking about where they are in the standings right now. They're right below that second place spot. If they beat Cloud9, then they're tied for third with TSM and Cloud9, and one game back from second. So Energy making this back half of the split surge for themselves, trying to prove that they do belong in this top half. It's been something that they've been struggling with because their early game has been their problem.
Right.
Their early game struggle from day one, where they had to steal Baron twice with GBM. This team plays well from behind, but they keep getting behind, and that's the problem. Balls is splitting, he has TP, Baron has started. Twisted Fate looking for the flank, they peel off.
Balls on the bot side, Twisted Fate on the left here. They have them completely surrounded. Actually, Balls leads towards the top. Now it's two aside. I should say five aside for two teams.
Yep.
As 6 seconds on the dragon, really not gonna be in anybody's eyes just yet. It'll be an afterthought once this battle happens. If it even does. That ultimate, not actually doing that much damage. Jensen is caught, flashes up, he can go right over the wall.
Altec
primes that position and puts himself there immediately. 50 seconds plus on these timers. A lot can be gained if more than three members drop for a team here. Or if it is that priority wave clear, that's gonna be Ball staying alive. That'll help get these turrets cleaned up along with Sneaky. Energy can look to grab a little bit more vision around the map here, and looks like they will not try for Baron.
They have to defend their base. Their base has super minions pushing into it, so this Baron just gives them a little bit of a respite so they can take a breath. Mm-hmm.
Me too.
Yeah, you too. Clear some minion waves, get some extra gold for themselves. Dragon is up. It'll be third for C9. It'll be second for Energy if they're able to take it. But yeah, that's TP down for Balls. And playing around that window of where this composition is operating is important.
Dragon number three, four of the game. Energy was able to slip one in a little bit earlier, which stalls Cloud9's chances to get that five, but three makes it that much more of a possibility now.
It's a nice little play there from Rush with the scuttle swag. Q's to it, W's immediately to Sneaky. I don't even care about this thing. I'm just trying to get to the dragon faster.
Gotta make it look good.
Yep.
Keeps his APM up.
Keep baiting Baron, though. If you're Energy, just keep baiting Baron.
Where
you won the previous fight.
You group him up.
Go back to it. Hope the C9 make a similar mistake. And now Jensen has his ultimate up almost. Has it up now. But Balls has no TP, so Balls has to stay nearby. So it'll be a 4-on-5, and then Jensen's the one splitting. And that wave is so far out. Thanks. Oh, there's a banner command minion that bot side, so it's pushing.
I was looking for it. I saw it on cooldown. Culling goes out, more like the tickling. Energy still very healthy. Two-man pulverize. Not much follow-up coming in. He now throws down the ultimate a little bit late, but he's able to make it out safely, and he may be able to go for another Headbutt Pulverize. The team would need that crowd control. Rush flies in. Where's the follow-up? Sneaky's there on the edge, hooked in by Impact. Now they're going on Jensen, flashed out by Mood.
Altec.
Everybody's deciding whether they want in or out, and they can't figure it out right now. A few have fallen. That's Rush down. Bleeding bars on the side of Energy, and they finally start to bleed out. That's going to be more kills coming in. Sneaky gets those shutdowns. 14-14 in the end, but Cloud9 stands tall.
That's an incredible team fight there from both teams, kiting back and forth. Who goes in, who goes out, who's taking damage? Look at the health bars
absolutely
on all
crazy.
Of these members.
They push themselves to
balls goes down.
Limit. Still pushing themselves to the limit. Baron picking up some extra gold. That's very nice.
Baron just killed more members of C9 than Energy did. Sneaky.
Sign him up. Calling,
soften them up a little bit. Jensen, he's not going to engage completely with his ultimate. He goes off to the left side to get an angle on this fight because the AD carries have moved up a little bit. Ulti, off on the left side. Comes up, hits Moon over the wall, and then this is it. Balls back and forth. Sneaky in the backline, had to avoid the Impact ultimate. Rush dies off the engage, but the wild cards have already been chunking the backline. Altec has to go back. Moon, eat in, flashed out because he couldn't reach Jensen. Jensen peeled backwards, and then the wild cards, and Jensen is really just doing so much work in this fight. The damage dealers of C9 and the support that they were getting, Black Shield on the right person. Movement speed given by Whimsy to the right person at the right time. Sneaky making sure nobody else gets hit by Impact Ultimate. And Jensen with the cleanup from the side.
Right.
As well as he was softening them the entire time. Cleanup is a lie because he was throwing out cards the entire time and playing around that cooldown.
Very
that was
well
sick.
Fought. It's the fights I like. 34 minutes in. It definitely pushed that kill score much, much higher. And we now see double Lichbane coming out here. Once C9 makes it to any more of these turrets, they are not long for this world.
Double Lichbane.
I guess the Rift world.
1-3-1 is available now with balls with the TP. Altec on the bot side, and this blue Ezreal, it's going to take a bit. Yeah.
Just try to clear it.
The minions.
It's like watching Vlad push a turret.
Actually, it probably takes about the same speed.
Oh. They've routed the extra minions here, knowing that the Banner of Command will die shortly.
Balls, where's that wave?
We're waiting.
It's a little bit late.
So mid's even and clean. Bottom's not really going to be too much in their mind here. I think it actually could be top mid game if this fight happens in their favor. It'll be very tough here for Energy. But again, they're getting what they want. Cloud9's going to be grouping here in a second. So the siege might be the difficult part.
Yeah. Impact is a little bit weak to magic damage right now because he went for multiple.
Right, he's just put that Negatron cloak in now.
Yeah, he's sitting at 140, 146, so he's got a decent amount because the Banner of Command as well.
Oh, that's right. But the Aegis in there.
He needs to go for that last one there, which looks like it'll be a Zerat portal, unless he's going for Abyssal Scepter to help out GPM. See though, Conquan. Oh, what is he doing? Caught out. He's trying to pull a Kiwi Kid, trying to flank them, and they smelled him.
Went down very fast. The Headbutt Pulverize really in reaction to try and save himself even more. Maybe caught out warding. But that gives Cloud9 some much needed room. And that really is what the Conquan going down, what they were worried about.
Yeah.
Down the turret.
Conquan, there was a blue ward in there.
Right.
And then he went to clear it, and then he backed on where he had cleared it. And they just placed another one and caught him. GBM though, a significant poke.
High, low, but he can stay on the outside and keep throwing in the bindings. Looks like they aren't going to go for this just yet. They decide to back off. Mid lane could be down. Push down here. Altec and the rest of the team are going to try to get up. Put some vision down. 37 minutes in. These fights are going to be quite difficult. True Shot Barrage down towards the bottom wave, so they don't have to worry about any quick TPs in from Jensen to drop a turret.
And in terms of item advantages, we're seeing them all across the board here for C9. Full item for Jensen over GBM. Some lanes are actually quite even in terms of what they've completed.
Huh.
Muramana for Altec, ready to go. Last Whisper seems to be what he has in mind next, as well as Maw. And right now, Energy, you're waiting for when you have these item spikes, because when you're getting to this late game, the goal is going to start meaning less and less, and as C9 hits six items, they've plateaued.
Yep.
Waiting for that point, but there are two more dragons before C9 ends up getting 5. Yeah. This next dragon, if Energy are able to secure it, they give themselves some extra time to get to that point. Oh. In the front though, Sneaky
They're
going for food.
Giving him the 5v5 right now. Sneaky up in the front line. Oh, the collateral damage going over to the Jensen cards as he gated in, but it was too early and he misses both targets. A nice true shot barrage through the team, but the squishies are on the back line. That's where Conquan just got. Where's the rest of Energy though? So split and taking single target damage from multiple members of Cloud9. Now over to Altec. Balls over the wall. He is just flying through with the whimsy. They ace down Energy.
And that's how C9 plays this composition. Perfect execution there. C9 with the catches, with the dividing of the fight, end up taking this turret. They're gonna just ignore it. They're gonna go for the inhibitor,
straight
push
pass.
This down, go for that Nexus here, and C9 will tie for second place at the end of week 6.
A few blunders, but they were able to right the wrongs that were happening. They found the fights they needed, and Cloud9 takes down Energy Esports.
Focusing Moon in that last fight, just jump on him, throw everybody you can at him, but also keep the rest of that front line busy. So they went after Moon. They've singled him out as a weak spot on the team in these positioning. And they're able to get themselves this win here, and Cloud9 moved to 8-4, tied with CLG, I believe. Yeah, with CLG. And
I was like,
go above TSM.
It's like watching a Sivir comp. they had slows to kind of facilitate their catch, not a huge speed up. They were all over Energy every time they wanted to be. And Energy as well, definitely noticing their win conditions in the game and trying to promote those factors. They were easily able to bait Cloud9 into that five-man fight multiple times. But then Cloud9 actually said, all right, if they're going to want the five-man fight, how do we prioritize our targets and win that fight if that's what they always want? Able to take that final fight to Energy and straight down the lane. Energy as well, gaining most of the Barons in this one. Still not able to get themselves too far ahead.
Yep. Energy, Altec having another great game in terms of damage per minute, sitting at 30,000 damage. He did the same damage as GBM and Moon combined, each at 15K. So Altec stepped up here. But on the opposite side, we see a lot of damage coming out from Cloud9. They're working as a team here, and Balls, not a whole lot this game. You know, he's fourth in damage on his team, just right above high, but he played a supportive role.
Right. That's what I was going to bring up. There's that switch after coming out so strong on previous games of Fiora and his game on Gangplank. Can still switch that style up and play what the team needs. As well, Rush coming through huge on these Lee Sin plays. It was Lee Sin. Three games now, two Nunus before that, two Nidalees before that. So he's kind of sticking with what feels good on the plate. And that last time it was a Guardian Angel. This game it was the Titanic Hydra with a Banshee's Veil on top of his warrior. He's kind of doing what he wants.
Well, when you know a champion so well, you can recognize a situation where, okay, did I get one kill early? Now I go for this item. Two kills early? This one feels really good. So you can adjust your build based on how the game has been going and the flow and what's on the other side. And when he's up against a bunch of AD carries, it's actually really good because what Titanic Hydra will do is it's a full auto attack reset. So if I Q you, I take the Q, I auto, and then I Titanic Hydra. I use both charges of his passive to get energy back, so he's never having to worry about that
the 1-2
in the middle of a fight. And I think that that was something that he went for there. And I think he kind of baited us with the Nunu when he was playing it before, because now he's just like, oh, yeah, by the way, I haven't played this yet. I played it back in week one, game one, and now they're letting me play it again. So let's go.
This week. Having that versatility is amazing, and it seems to be paying off for Cloud9 across the board. But now to break down a team fight from that game, let's head to the Telestrator for a lesson with Professor Kobe.
Thank you, Riv. And yes, I know Cloud9 games have a bunch of exciting team fights in them. There's a lot going on. But I wanted to switch it up and take you back to a simpler time. You know, do a different segment this time around, just focusing on the First Blood. And I really want to walk you through the decision-making process that junglers have that goes through their heads in the early game. Because the early game may seem calm, but there's so many things that a jungler has to evaluate constantly before going for their moves. Let's take this example here for Energy. We have Moon on Graves, and he's just found a pink ward, which is great. However, it did pop his Oracle's Raptor buff over his head, which you can see now. And that is going to be important for the next invade that he goes for, because he won't know if he walks over any subsequent wards deep in Cloud9's jungle. So yes, he's clearing out this ward, By clearing out that ward, not only does it give him money, it also tells Rush where he is. So let's roll this through and we'll see what happens. Moon clears out the ward, his Raptor buff is ticking, but he still feels confident enough to go invade Rush, even though he hasn't seen Rush pretty much all game long, who has been farming. And Rush is on Lee Sin. Let's pause it here, because Rush has been on Lee Sin hard farming the whole time. If you click on them, you'll actually see that Rush has not only red buff, but also the Gromp buff. And it gives him a lot of power in the early game, a lot of damage over time that you don't necessarily see in the one versus one. And Moon, going for this second step of his deep invade without the Raptor buff, to know that he's gone over any wards is a very dangerous situation. He actually didn't walk over any other wards, but Rush, seeing him clear the pink ward, thought about it, predicted where he was gonna go on the invade, and went to cut him off. Now, the super important thing as a jungler, we'll try and use red here, is the mid laner's as well as the top laner's ability to collapse to any jungle fight. As you can see here, Moon went for this invade. His mid laner is a little bit behind, pushed up to the turret, that's GBM, and the top laner is about even. So it's a little bit risky of an invade, and Rush probably has the advantage as far as support from the rest of his team. Now we'll watch at the actual fight, because those are all things that are going on in the back of a jungler's mind, but you still have to simulate the one versus one fight and figure out if you can actually beat this guy. Rush knows that he has the advantage, gets the early cripple onto Moon. Let's take a look here and roll the rest of the clip. Moon is going to get one auto, that procs the damage buff here. Pause it again. We'll see red buff is ticking, the Gromp buff is ticking, Rush got the early Q on him, and he's thinking, Moon does the right thing here. He's next to the wall, doesn't go over the wall early, because he knows that Rush can follow that second Sonic wave, so he's thinking through the fight himself as well. The only problem is that Lee Sin has just as many dashes and gap closers as Graves does. So even though he waits for the full duration of that Q to go off, and Rush, you know, being a Lee Sin god, knows the full duration he can wait and makes Moon wait on this side of the wall as long as possible, is gonna instantly follow him with a ward hop. Now we can run out the rest of this and see how Rush is able to instantly follow. He knows exactly Moon's escape path because both these guys are experienced junglers. They know exactly what Rush is looking for. The other thing that Rush did right there, which you may not notice, but definitely has a big impact, because Graves had boots, it was so important for Rush to immediately directly input a move command after each auto that he pulled off. So he immediately start the auto animation of Lee Sin and then directly input another move so he can keep up even without the boots due to the move speed slow of both the cripple and the red buff, which ran off. Also, then we see the implications. Jensen was able to move in first and he's Twisted Fate. He has the gold card, trumps the speed up there from GBM's collapse, and Rush does get the first blood for Cloud9 with all of that going through his head. So even though there are all these crazy fights going on, I like to bring it back to junglers because they think about the game quite a lot and you don't get to see that. So over to Dash now because they've got some members of Cloud9 ready to talk about their win.
All right, well, that was a lot of information to take in. Hopefully you all internalize it because it's good information and can help you improve greatly. But I'm sitting here with a couple of victorious members of Cloud9, Jensen and Sneaky, after taking out Energy, who sat just below you in the standings. You guys are keeping yourselves in that conversation for top two right next to CLG. I want to start first, though, with something that we've kind of noticed, maybe a trend or just a pattern here with Cloud9. You guys seem to be incredibly comfortable playing single tank or single frontline compositions, whereas a lot of other NALCS teams we've witnessed are looking for at least two frontliners. We'll see it come from the support and the jungler, or the top laner and the jungler. You guys, though, in this game and in games prior, a lot of times it's just Rush being the tank. Maybe an Alistar creeps in there. Is there any reason, Jensen, that you can speak to why Cloud9 is so comfortable playing with only one frontliner?
Well, we know Rush will do his job as a frontliner, and I don't think we particularly like look to only run one tank. It just happens, and we just pick what we feel comfortable playing, and it just works out.
How does a smaller frontline affect the way that you approach a team fight, knowing that you have less barriers between their threats and you two, for example, being two of the bigger carries?
Well, with all comp, we kind of had a lot of options what we could do in team fights. We could either dive in or just hit their front line. So we kind of have to go for different approaches to a team fight, and because our front line won't last as long as theirs. So if we can like try to get on their back line, we can also win the fight.
Okay, all this aside though, something has very clearly clicked for Cloud9 this split. You guys are in that conversation for top two, and this is what I really want to focus on. Sneaky, can you pinpoint for us what it is about this team that changed between last split, this split, the first few weeks, and these later weeks that really turned things on for you guys?
I'd just say we're having a good time, honestly. We're having a lot of fun during our scrims. We're not, like, screwing around a lot of time, but even in losses, we're, like, happy about it. I mean, not specifically that we lost, but, like, our attitudes about the game are just more happy than they used to be. Like, obviously, we had some pretty big changes last split because we had to switch out junglers and stuff, but now we're just here with a whole new roster with high support in Rush Jungle, and it's working out well just because we're good friends.
Yep, camaraderie and good vibes are always helpful. You mentioned the roster swap, bringing in a new jungler, Rush. I want to kind of pinpoint your relationship with Rush. Something that a lot of people pointed to was how that synergy would develop between the jungler and the mid laner. So in a similar line of questioning to what I just threw to Sneaky, if we zero in on just your relationship with Rush, how have you two been improving this split to make sure that you can perform at this top NA level?
Well, at first, me and Rush, we were always like pretty close and good friends, but I feel like in the start we didn't synergize that well. Not that there wasn't really anything particular, but I just feel like right now we're just playing really strong together as a duo, and we just understand each other a lot better than we did in the start. So now everything is just working out really good for us.
And that clip there that Kobe showed too was a pretty good example of how communication is working just a little bit crisper for you guys. You're the first one to rotate out of the two mid laners, so things definitely turning out for you there. Now what if we pull the conversation all the way back out and we look at all three of the teams that are kind of in that contention for the top two spot? Now TSM did lose today, but TSM, CLG, Cloud9, Sneaky, back to you. What are the major differences between these three teams?
I mean, there's not too many of them since we're all so close in the standings. TSM's like one win behind us and CLG, and then we beat CLG last time. We just beat TSM, but we're still tied with TSM. So, I mean, we're all in contention for second, although I don't think any of us can reach first, unfortunately. But yeah, there's like no playstyle differences that I can necessarily point out. Like, we're all strong teams. We kind of do what we want to do and just figure out what's the best in the patch.
Now, you mentioned that perhaps it's not quite possible for you guys to reach that number one slot with Immortals being on the run that they are on. Jensen, I'm gonna ask you, I'm going to press you to maybe come up with a reason why they've been separated from the pack. What is it that Immortals does better than any other team in the NALCS?
I feel like they just clicked as a team from the beginning, and they all like have play styles that fit with each other, and then Reynova and Huni coming in together as a strong duo understand each other very well, and then yeah, I just feel like they just had a pretty good like base with like how their team worked from the beginning, and that's why I feel like they had such a good start and is playing much better than everyone else. I can't really pinpoint any specific reason. I just feel like they're just a team that works good together.
Now, early at the very beginning of the day, I pitched the question to Dyrus, which of these top three, or these, I guess, next three teams, TSM, CLG, Cloud9, is going to be the one to take down Immortals if it does happen at any point. He had said TSM if he's going with his heart, Cloud9 if he's going with his head. Right back to you, Jensen. I know that you have no more regular season games against them, but if you come up against them in the playoffs, how confident are you that you guys can take them out when you meet them once again?
I'm feeling pretty confident if we're going up against them. I'm pretty sure we are going to body these fools.
I like it. There it was, ladies and gentlemen. We heard it from Jensen, the mid laner himself. Didn't even have to come from high. They're going to body these fools. Gentlemen, congratulations on the victory today. Can't wait to see you guys play in only 6 days' time. When we come back, Team Impulse and Echo Fox will battle to see who can break the tie and move up the standings. We're back in 3.5. Same.
Give me, yeah! Give me, please! Hey, here! Hey! Hey, give me here! Please! Why don't give me? Hey, I'm human too.
The shield is on six! The soul shackle!
Those things are in range!
Oh, he got him into the turret! You gotta be kidding! The best of a worst situation! Oh! Kangquan makes it happen!
Go where the bush, where the bush, kill him, kill him, kill him, go, go, go! Take my mom! Careful of this Q, careful of the Q, careful of the Q! Jensen got a guard.
Nice, nice.
Push.
It's really just a fight bait. A huge monster Q from GVM wipes the health bars of Cloud9.
No NA bait run.
Now over to Alltech. Balls over the wall. He is just flying through with the whimsy. They ace down energy.
And C9 will tie for second place at the end of week 6.